In this video, we'll compare Ruby on Rails with Node.js. We'll start by measuring latency from the client side, focusing on P99 percentile. Then we'll measure throughput using request per second metric and generate enough load to find the breaking point for both applications. After that, we'll look at saturation of the services or how full they get under the load. We'll also track CPU usage relative to the Kubernetes limit defined in the pod, along with memory usage. Since we deploy both applications to Kubernetes, we'll monitor CPU throttling as well. Next, we'll measure availability or error rate, defined as the ratio of successful requests to the total number of requests received by the application. These are the main metrics to monitor when you deploy a client-facing web application. For the second test, I added Prometheus metrics to both applications. This will allow us to measure how long it takes each app to save data into a relational database, in this case, Postgres. We'll also monitor CPU usage of the database and the connection pool size. To run these tests, I use AWS. I create EKS cluster with two instance groups. Ruby on Rails and Node.js each have their dedicated nodes deployed on M7A large instances. I deploy all my clients which generate load on Graviton four extra large instances with approximately 20 pods per application. Finally, I use specialized EC2 instance with a local SSD disk to run the Postgres database. For the Ruby on Rails setup, I generated the project in IP mode only, creating a slightly reduced version. I'm not using server-side rendering here, but I plan to include it in the next test with Django. In the first test, I hardcoded three devices directly into the controller. For the second test, I used the controller's create method, which is almost the default setup. Also, I generate and add UUID to each device object. To monitor application with Prometheus, I used Prometheus client gem. I then created a singleton class for Prometheus and defined a histogram with a bunch of buckets to make the test results more accurate. Then I listen for the device create active record event and use it to measure database latency. Feel free to refactor and submit a pull request. It's not the cleanest version, but it works. For deployment, I use two replicas, each limited to a single CPU. Typically, you would run a single worker or process inside a container, but I spent a few hours optimizing application. With default settings, it could only handle about 400 requests per second. I experimented with a number of workers and threads per worker and found that this specific configuration to offer the best balance of throughput and latency. Deploying Ruby on Rails on Kubernetes is different from deploying on virtual machine or bare metal server, where the number of workers should match the CPU cores, with threads adjusted for latency and throughput. For Node.js, I used the standard library and hardcoded the same devices. I also set up Prometheus histogram with identical buckets, which is essential for accurate comparison between different applications. I used Postgres Node.js driver to insert item into the database and replicated the database schema from the Rails application and even used the same SQL insert statement as Rails, which returns database ID. For deployment, I used similar configuration, two replicas with the same pod requests and limits. Keep in mind that Node.js is not the fastest JavaScript runtime. Take a look at this benchmark between Dina V2, Bun, and Node.js. I used the latest version available for both applications at the time of the test. Alright, let's go ahead and run the first test. The entire test took around 2 hours, but I'll compress it to just a few minutes. In the top right graph, you can see the number of requests per second, and we'll gradually increase it until both applications fail. On the left-hand side, you can see the latency measured using P99 percentile, meaning 99 of all requests are completed within that time range. The latency is very consistent at the start for both applications. Ruby on Rails is noticeably slower, partially because it's a full-fledged framework with a lot of middleware, optimized for development speed rather than performance. but it is slower, with CPU usage also much higher. Since I deploy two instances for each application, I use average value to measure both CPU and memory usage relative to the limit. On the right-hand side, the memory usage is around 46%, primarily because I run two independent workers in the container. If you create one worker per container, memory usage would be around 20%. At around 37% CPU usage, you start to notice that Kubernetes begins to throttle Ruby on Rails. This is partially due to having two workers per container. If you create a single worker, it won't throttle until 60%, but throughput will also be significantly reduced. Based on my experience, Ruby on Rails is not the ideal application to deploy in Kubernetes. At around 1800 requests per second, Ruby on Rails starts to degrade and can't process the same amount of requests as Node.js, with its latency also increasing. At around 2500 requests per second, it's clear that this is the maximum number of requests Ruby on Rails can handle. I decided to speed up a test a bit and deploy more clients for Node.js. The maximum number of requests that Node.js can handle is consistent with this type of EC2 instance, reaching almost 50,000 requests per second with CPU usage close to 90%. I think the latest Node.js runtime performs very well in terms of latency and throughput. Let's go over each graph for the entire test duration. First, we have requests per second graph. As you can see, Ruby on Rails was only able to handle 2500 requests per second, while Node.js was able to reach almost 50,000, which is a huge difference. Next, we have latency graph for the entire test. You can see a slight increase in latency for Node.js at the end of the test. And at the beginning, Node.js latency is much lower as well. The next graph is CPU usage. Ruby on Rails reached about 76%. You could potentially adjust the number of workers and threads to increase this slightly, but I don't think there is much to gain. Then we have the memory usage graph. As I mentioned, the difference is significant mostly because I used two workers in the container. If configured with one worker, memory usage for Ruby on Rails would be around 20%, which is still twice that of the Node.js. Next is the availability graph. I had to increase the client timeout to 500 milliseconds, which is why only Ruby shows as failing in this graph. And finally, we have CPU throttling graph. As a DevOps engineer, not a Ruby on Rails developer, I prioritize performance over development speed. This is a compromise you need to make for yourself. Now, the second test is closer to real-world scenarios. Almost all applications require some kind of persistence layer, especially stateless applications, also called cloud-native applications. In this test, you can also see that overall latency for Ruby on Rails is significantly higher than Node.js. Additionally, I included a graph using internal application metrics to measure how long it takes to save item to the database. This graph is not exception. Ruby on Rails is slower. Based on my previous tests, Node.js has consistently been one of the fastest applications in terms of database interactions, so the results here are not surprising. Similar to the previous test, CPU usage is also much higher for Ruby on Rails compared to Node.js. At around 1200 requests per second, Ruby on Rails started to degrade and its latency spiked. You can also see that Kubernetes throttling Rails at this point, which is a reason for the high latency. In this test, Ruby on Rails managed only about 1500 requests per second. So I decided to deploy additional clients to find the breaking point for Node.js. For this test, I used extra large EC2 instance for Postgres, so it's not a bottleneck anymore, and optimized it with pgTune for the hardware I used. At around 13,000 requests per second, Node.js also began to degrade, reaching about 90% CPU usage. Let me go through each graph for the entire test duration. First, we have request per second graph. Here you can see that Ruby on Rails only reached 1500 requests per second, while Node.js performed much better, reaching 13,000 requests per second. Next is the overall latency for the entire request. Even from the start, the latency difference is significant. Then we have the database latency graph. It appears that Ruby on Rails reached a default timeout at around 17 seconds, while Node.js performed much better in this test. Next is the Postgres CPU usage, which only reached 50% during this test. When optimizing your application, remember that the bottleneck is often another persistence layer or a different microservice dependency. Monitoring all components is essential. Following that, we have CPU usage of our applications. Then memory usage. In the availability graph, you don't see any downward spikes because I increased the timeout to 1 second for this test. Finally, we have CPU throttling. Similar to the previous test, you might choose Ruby on Rails if you prioritize development speed or already have experience with it, while Node.js would be better if you aim for the performance. Keep in mind that Node.js is not the fastest JavaScript framework. Dina and Ban are other options. I have other benchmarks on my channel if you're interested. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you in next video.